Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to KPMG Canary Wharf. I'm sure you noticed when you came in the enormous, not quite sure what to call, kind of poster flips telling you about KPMG's carbon responsibility and all of our UK environmental commitments. I was just saying to Georg earlier on, in recognition of, we didn't put them up in recognition of you, Georg, although that would be tempting, but it is a recognition of the success of what he has achieved and the Global Compact have achieved, that businesses like ours want to actively demonstrate and display the seriousness of commitments to the environment, to communities, to human rights, and to responsibility in labour relations. What the compact has been for the last 15 years is the signature statement of a series of mature principles that, had they not been there, it would be difficult to imagine how our world would look. Yesterday, the G7 nations agreed to end fossil fuel dependency by 2100. I'm tempted to say to the Americans in the room, sorry, I hope you're no Americans, believe it if you see it, but it is an important step. The big debate over what will be the outcomes of December's climate talks, the opportunities the Sustainable Development Goals will represent in September, the long-term promise that we will see the eradication of extreme poverty and hunger by 2030, the prospects we can save the planet from overboiling itself to the point where we cannot survive, and the migration that we've all witnessed with such pain from desperate communities on the continent of Africa to what people believe are the greener fields of Europe. All these things are signs of a world in chaos. And what's needed are a combination of maturity and decisions and commitments. Georg was reminding me that it was 17 years ago to this month that he had the first conversations here in London. That's why he's here, to give his great valedictory retirement lecture. That it was here in London that he began to dream that the UN would be passionate about business responsibility. And 15 years ago, that the compact was birthed, for which he has led it with such extreme excellence over that period of time, and now must, in a short period, wave goodbye to a glorious future. He will never ever rest on the back of such great success. To have gathered thousands of companies together, Mark Moody Stewart here as chairman of the UN Global Compact, Chris Harrop here, who leads the organization here in the UK, to have led so many businesses to such strong common commitments is a sign of not just his charm, but actually more importantly, his intelligence. He reminds me that he's an engineer, and as an engineer, I actually asked him a question just a few minutes ago. How long does it take to go all the way through the center of the earth to the other side if you could just drop into a hole and get from London to Sydney without having to fly? The answer to the question is actually 38 minutes, if there was such a hole. But he reminded me that the minute you get to the center of the earth where the temperature is 44,000 degrees, you will hit a gravity problem and you'll struggle to get up the hill the other way around. That's the clever brains of the engineer. I just fancied the opportunity. That's the difference between the two of us. But it is an amazing opportunity to have Georg here in what is going to be, in effect, his, I was about to say, last full month in charge. But in reality, he will continue to be the name and the face of the UN Global Compact for a generation to come. We all treasure him so much and respect him so much. I just wanted to flag one other thing in talking about the place that business plays. Yesterday's Financial Times, and those of you who know me well know I can't resist a newspaper front page, so I had to go to the companies and markets section of the Financial Times yesterday. Banks' post-crisis legal costs hit £200 billion. Now, if you work that out in dollars, that is roughly around $340 billion. The Financial Times also recorded yesterday on the front page, just here, the little chart of overseas development commitments made by the world's leading developed economies. The UK, thankfully, is in the position of being the only one of major economies to committed to 0.7% and delivering. Germany at around about half the UK's level, France declining, Canada declining, Japan, US, Italy climbing. But here's the figure to set against it. So if the banks, 16 banks, have paid out £340 billion in fines, the statement of global commitment in the course of the last year is $135 billion. Fixing the world requires business to be more responsible. And people say that there's not money to be spent on the priorities that need to be in the front of our face as we face the pressures of the real poor and the real destitute. Well, I know Georg has always believed that not only are the resources available, but the willpower is available. It's the decisions that will link the two. So I hope that when Georg addresses us in a minute, we will not just receive his words from someone who's sat and observed the great companies of the world, but actually receive his words as a direction for our own future commitment. I just wanted you to appreciate Sir Mark Moody Stewart. I wonder if you might stand up, Mark. Just appreciate him as the chairman of the Global Compact. Also Chris Harrop, who leads the UK office. So the biggest applause for the morning must go to Georg Kell. We want to hear your words, receive them, respect what you say, and be obedient. Thank you.
Good morning, everybody. It's an enormous privilege to have your attention so early in the day. Fresh brains. Thank you, Michael. Thank you, Sir Mark. Mark, for inviting. It's a real honor and a privilege. Both of you have been friends. You have given guidance, and I want to salute especially Sir Mark, whose friendship has meant so much to me, and without whose help I could not have grown the Global Compact. Sir Mark has been the vice chair of the board from its inception and as the chair of the foundation. He has been overlooking now many of our operations, and so Mark knows all the insides outs of the Global Compact. Thank you so Mark for your friendship. It means all the world to me. Giving my retirement talk here is like a homecoming. The City of London means much to me, and not just because as a 16-year-old runaway from home, I learned how to survive in the streets of this city. But more importantly, because the decision to launch the Global Compact was made here in London, because many people, individuals, gave shape and direction to the initiative, especially in the early days. And there are too many names, really, I would need to list, but I do want to list at least two or three of them, who in the very early days played a very critical role. The late Geoffrey Chandler, one of them, no doubt. Then the late Robert Davis, who was a dear friend and who in many ways gave shape and direction. Jane Nelson, John Elkington, Simon Sadek, to mention just a few of the names who gave the intellectual vibrancy, Malcolm McIntosh, and many more, many more. And of course, business leaders in the late 90s here, Sir Mark, who was then the chairman of Shell, and Lord John Brown, who was chair of British Petroleum. Both of them have given critical direction impetus. So it is the Compact virtually was given its birth and its direction. It's a privilege to be here again. What I want to talk about today is four aspects. One is I want to share a little bit the story of the Global Compact from the inside out. Secondly, I want to reflect on the main changes that have taken place in this space on the changing business-society relationship, because sometimes we are carried away by day-to-day activities and we do not see how the big picture is really moving ahead. Thirdly, I want to speculate a little bit about pathways for the future, what could come next, what could be done. And lastly, I want to talk a bit about personal lessons learned, kind of personal reflections. Lord Hastings challenged me to put emphasis on this. So let me start off by telling a little bit the story of the Global Compact itself. The Compact was never intended to be an initiative. It was just meant to be a good policy speech. And it started exactly 17 years ago when John Ruggie, who was then senior advisor to the former Secretary General Kofi Annan, came to my office and said, look, the boss decided not to go to the next World Economic Forum unless we have something really good for him. So can you produce something really good? So we started working on a speech, and the writing was on the wall: fragility of globalization, backlash, business starting to go global, governments remaining local. On the trade side, much progress, WTO in the making, China joining, positive optimism. On the other hand, the neglect of human rights, the backlash, the social clause, environmental pollution being a big issue, incidences around the world. So there was a growing gap, a growing misperception. It was time to call on business to play their role, to step up and to recognize that power and responsibility cannot be separated. So a speech was made called the Global Compact, which the former Secretary General Kofi Annan delivered in January 2000 at the World Economic Forum. And the speech hit the wrong nerve. It was the zeitgeist of the moment. CEOs understood the fragility of globalization. They understood that openness must be earned in the public face. They understood that policymakers needed to be able to convince the electorate to support open regimes. It was a moral call. Initially, many CEOs reacted, many ambassadors reacted and said, look, wonderful words, giving globalization a new world face, wonderful words, but you need to build something, you need to translate this vision into an initiative. Initially, we were very reluctant, because our job was really to deliver a good speech for the boss. So we started dialogue sessions with civil society, with business leaders, and just here outside Heathrow Airport, a very historic meeting took place, and there are some witnesses here, Mr. Baxter is here, where NGOs and civil society came together and decided basically to translate the speech into something operational. So we went for a launch event in New York in the year 2000, at which point it was clear there was no return. The Global Compact had to become an operational initiative. The speech had to be translated into something that could walk and talk, something that could engage, something that could advance through learning, through partnerships, and through dialogue. And this is where a long journey of 15 years of building that started, and I will spare you all this story, but it went through very distinct phases. In the beginning, it was just learning how to walk and talk, how to explain the moral imperative. Then it became a phase of building an infrastructure, global infrastructure, that is supported locally and grows locally, local networks. Then came a phase of how to come to grips with accountability and disclosure. How can you reconcile a voluntary concept with a mandatory annual disclosure? Then came a phase of differentiation. Once numbers grow, you have to learn how to keep the front end growing while on the tail end stay open to keep the dynamics of the system in a growth space. And now I believe we have entered into a potential phase of transformation where business engagement has become so material and serious that ultimately there's an opportunity to genuinely have transformative impact and change. So this is, in short, in a nutshell, the story of the Global Compact. Basically, it is a speech act, because it was just a speech initially. But out of a speech then grew by circumstantial forces an initiative. So what has really changed over the last 15 years, and what are the major lessons? I think, looking back now, I can say with near certainty that a silent revolution is taking place within the market. What started off as a moral imperative, doing the right thing, what used to be a reaction to incidences, largely, be it environmental disasters, be it accusations of human rights abuses, or supply chain sweatshop campaigns threatening consumer boycotts. 15 years ago, corporations used to react to disaster. It was brand management, it was disaster management. today it is a forward-looking strategic concept. Today, more and more companies do know and understand that long-term financial success can only be safeguarded if it goes hand in hand with environmental stewardship, good social track record, and good governance. Failure on either of these three pillars, ESG, will make it virtually impossible to either become or to stay in a leadership position in the market. This material imperative has now and is increasingly complementing the moral imperative of doing the right thing. They both reinforce each other, and they both actually drive the agenda currently forward. Our implementation survey, which we do annually, shows how more and more corporations have moved these issues up in the internal agenda. It used to be at the communications level. Increasingly, it is a matter of boards to oversee these issues. We can measure now how principles have slowly but increasingly penetrated strategies and operations, how they started first at headquarters and now they're moving out through the supply chain. We have SEDEX here in London, and they, I'm sure, can provide the additional evidence on that too. Later this month, on 25th of June in New York, when we will mark our 15th anniversary, we will also unveil a major review and assessment study, which we're doing together with DNVGL, which will show how change over the last 15 years can be measured and how the silent revolution within markets is actually progressing. Just two brief figures. Companies participating in our water mandate, for example, have already saved more than 80,000 million cubic meters of water. Companies in the Caring for Climate initiative are well on their way of cutting 125 millions of tons of CO2 emissions and so forth. So the change is quite systemic, it's big. There are today 8,400 active corporations in the compact from 150 countries. Roughly 90 networks are up and running around the world. More and more of these networks are gaining strength, what we call bottom up. And there's no doubt that so long as the world stays open and by and large peaceful, this agenda is irreversible and market transformation will proceed further. Why is that so? And I give you four reasons. One, transparency, like technological change itself, is irreversible. The low costs of information increasingly mandates companies, by and large, to be proactive, and it just no longer makes sense to hide anything, not even deep down in the supply chain. Transparency is on the rise and will continue to be on the rise, and is one of the major drivers out there. Secondly, as economic growth has long migrated to the east and to the south, investment has undergone a fundamental change. It used to be, not so long ago, almost exclusively about having access to cheap inputs, labor, resources. Increasingly, investment, in particular foreign direct investment, is about a bet for the future. Companies go to growth markets because they want to grow with the market. That means companies adopt a long-term perspective. They're part of society. When companies face growth barriers, they have an incentive to overcome them. If there are high systemic corruption costs, if you can reduce those costs, this is actually the right thing and a good thing to do. If there is a shortage of skilled labor, it makes sense to invest in vocational training. If there's scarcity of water supply and you depend on it, it makes sense to partner and to collaborate on water stewardship. In other words, as foreign direct investment in particular is increasingly about building markets, there's increasingly an incentive for business to embrace non-traditional financial issues and to partner on the solution finding. It's a fundamental shift to only 15 years ago when FDI was largely about access to cheap inputs for processing and then selling in traditional consumer markets. And that is the beauty of globalization. Thirdly, very important driver of misunderstood is, as the world is becoming more commercial, as business is going global, while governments remain, of course, local, they ever become more local, the line between what's public and private is blurring. think about the most, the ultimate public goods, water and the air. They're trying now to price the air, negative externalities. We have to put a price on water in many parts around the world. These are two public goods, which often are rightly seen as a basic human rights for people who have access to clean air and clean water. But because of scarcity, because of demographics, because of income growth, societies have to learn how to manage them in a more economic manner. The private sector has an enormous stake in pricing natural assets. The private sector can be part of the solution and it can be part of the problem. So here is a huge agenda out there which drives the E of the ESG agenda with certainty forward. And fourthly, digital empowerment worldwide means, among others, not only disruption and new changes in many areas, but it also means stakeholder engagement has taken on a material significance nobody can avoid anymore. Remember, not too long ago, the pretty useless debate about shareholder value versus the stakeholder value. It is so obvious and clear today that stakeholder engagement is absolutely essential to actually safeguard shareholder value over time. It's not one or the other, it's one for the other. And digital empowerment clearly will increasingly put a premium on that and will give it an ever more local meaning. So these are just four of the big trends that will continue to be with us for years to come. And they will drive this agenda forward, provided the world manages to sustain openness of markets and remains peaceful at large. So what are the prospects for the future? What are the pathways? Where are the breakthroughs possible? We have to admit that so far what we have accomplished together individually in this space, yes, while it has made a positive contribution, it has not yet arguably led to transformation. And Michael just reminded us about some of the grim figures out there, which suggest the world is actually moving in the wrong direction. So what can be done through business engagement to move towards a critical point, the transformation? I suggest there are four pathways in principle possible to move there. Each one has different assignment of probabilities, obviously, and nobody can predict the future anyway, but I believe these are four pathways in principle possible. The first one is the traditional critical mass notion. We have to recognize that corporate sustainability, while now being a global movement, it has not yet reached critical mass. Global Compact, 8,300 companies growing at the rate of 100 per month, but we also delist roughly 70 per month for failure to make an annual disclosure. It will take us a long time to have a majority of companies in this movement. Remember, there are roughly 50,000 publicly listed companies out there, and there are many 10,000 more of privately owned or small and medium-sized companies. So, yet, moving towards a critical mass is important, because at the end, to change markets from within on a voluntary basis can only happen if it becomes an established practice to do principles and to be responsible. And so long as many companies are still sitting on a fence, we just are not yet there. So first pathway has to be going to scale, trying to win over the fence sitters. Secondly, investors are catching up, and that is really the good news. The now London-based Principles for Responsible Investment, which we were lucky enough to have launched in the year 2005, now counts for over 1,300 asset managers and asset owners. They were initially slow, but they realized early on that non-traditional financial issues increasingly can have material impact for long-term returns. This thinking has grown and evolved now, and evidence is increasingly coming forward showing that companies which take on the material sustainability issues head-on, on average, actually deliver better financial returns over time. And as major asset owners are starting now to focus on this agenda, And as new asset managers are emerging, such as RFS, which is London-based here, that make this their core strategy, there's hope that financial markets, investment, will actually catch up with the business world that will increasingly drive this agenda forward. Today, I would argue, the world of finance is still lagging far behind the real economy by anything between 5 and 7 years. But the gap is closing, and the faster this gap is closing, the more it will drive the business agenda, the more it will help us to move towards transformation. I believe good collaboration with the financial markets now is key to move towards transformation, and it's arguably the most promising pathway for the future. Thirdly, it is quite conceivable that breakthroughs will be accomplished by specific themes. The world, by and large, still thinks in themes. Themes sometimes compete with each other, although if you look behind them, they're all interrelated. But I want to mention two in particular, because it is quite possible that within the next 2, 3, 4, 5 years, major breakthroughs will happen. The first one, obviously, is on climate change, and Michael just reminded us about the wonderful outcome of the G7. It's the end of this century. They will all be dead by then, but it's a great promise. It's a typical political promise. Nevertheless, something fundamental is changing in this space, and we can testify to this in many ways. For the first time, as far as I know, in the history of markets, our business leaders now prepared to not block climate action, but actually to advocate for it, because the space of green investment, the space of clean technology, is expanding much faster than the stagnant, carbon-intensive sector of the economy is. The pendulum is shifting, the opportunity space is growing, whereas the old space is stagnant, if not shrinking. So the momentum is shifting, and it's shifting quite fast, thanks to technological change, once again, but also thanks to changing mindsets and adopting a more long-term perspective on this. Within our own Caring for Climate operation, we're gearing up for Paris big time. Increasingly, CEOs are prepared to embrace what we call leadership criteria, which entails three quite tough benchmarks. The first one is to set a carbon price internally, which is high enough to materially affect internal investments. Not an easy thing for companies to do. Secondly, of course, you track and you measure your emissions, and thereby you contribute to the knowledge about how to create a market around carbon. And thirdly, arguably the toughest of all, is make sure your sustainability policies are aligned with your government affairs activities, i.e. do not lobby against climate action. On the contrary, become corporate statesmen, make the case for it. So this is still an uphill battle, but the agenda is changing now rapidly, and it is quite conceivable that within a short period of time, more and more CEOs will take on the leading edge of this movement and will actually help to bring about bold decisions that will lead to the pricing of negative externalities. And I just have to remind you, the IMF just recently, in a working paper, reminded us about the amount of post-tax subsidies for energy. It's a staggering $5.4 trillion, which is about 15 times more than the total climate finance the world is making available. 15 times more. In other words, just adjusting fiscal policies and making markets free from distorting incentives could easily solve the problem. And this, of course, could be done pro-poor, tax neutral. So the answer is in fiscal policies, most likely. The answer is in just putting the framework right again, so entrepreneurship, innovation can actually play its right role in this space. The second area where breakthrough is possible and quite conceivable and actually is already happening in many countries around the world is anti-corruption. It's the biggest cancer the world has. It destroys the credibility of politicians. It can lead to revolutions and anarchy. It is always at the expense of the poor, and by some estimates, the amount lost to developing countries is in excess of $1 trillion a year, many, many times over what the total official development assistance is. Not so long ago, bribery was tax deductible in major markets, no longer so. Regulatory changes, frameworks have improved, awareness has improved, transparency is on the rise. The business case for taking action against corruption has correspondingly grown significantly. We have in a number of important countries currently going on what we call collective action against corruption. The main driving force behind it is business leaders from India, from Nigeria, from Brazil and elsewhere, arguing we cannot become competitive if our own environment is corrupt and taxing us too highly. By bringing business leaders, civil society, both foreign and local companies together with government officials, not yet corrupt, by improving public procurement and working on integrity measures, a lot of progress can be made. So the business case for reducing corruption is becoming increasingly strong. And this is a great momentum that is happening now all over the world, and I'm quite optimistic that progress is possible and will be made in this phase as well. Another area where progress is actually happening very fast is in the social domain. The G7 also endorsed the Women's Empowerment Principles. There are now 1,000 CEOs who start to understand the power of unlocking non-discrimination, the power of inclusiveness. And this is very encouraging because this way of thinking is spreading fast in many countries. And in some countries, it's the macroeconomic case which wins the battle, such as Japan, where they discover now gender equality as a driving force. But in many other places around the world, it's a simple insight that non-discrimination at the workplace and inclusiveness is actually driving innovation. And companies that have global aspirations are understanding this even more so, because this is the way how you operate everywhere with a higher standard. So also in the social domain, progress is happening. And fourthly, I can assure you, the United Nations will do everything in its power to bring the voice of business to the table on these issues. As Michael hinted at, in September, the world community will adopt global sustainable development goals, the SDGs. For the first time in the history of the United Nations, universal goals will be set that actually are applicable everywhere. They're not north-south oriented, but they're global oriented, and they will cover all aspects of economic, social, and governance life. And there's a unique opportunity for business to use the SDGs to scale up collaborative effort, to align the long-term vision with the goals, to set in place measurements that actually show how one can contribute to it, and to collaborate at local level in particular. KPMG is doing a major piece of contribution here with its industry network. We're working with many partners in that field, and we will unveil in September what we call a compass for business to use the SDG to accelerate and to speed up collaboration in this area. Then there is, of course, later this year, COP21 in Paris, a pretty important gathering where hopefully all decisions will be taken on climate. However, the future is shaped also by geostrategy and by politics. The business society agenda, in the widest sense, depends on the bigger political context. 15 years ago, multilateralism was flying high. 15 years ago, the president of the International Chamber of Commerce, Helmut Maurer, CEO of Nestle, would write op-eds in the Financial Times, arguing basically that global markets need global rules. There was a firm commitment for integration, for rule-based integration. China was just about to join the WTO. There was optimism in the air, by and large. Bill Clinton had just managed to balance the budget. Tony Blair before Iraq. Lula became president in Brazil, showing you can escape. Today, we live in a world of fragmentation. Today, there's a much heightened sense of uncertainty. Today, there is in many places chaos. Fragmentation is happening at two levels. Between countries, the old order, shaped after World War II, is giving way to something new we don't know yet about. It's moving away from multilateralism to regional approaches, national approaches, and sometimes even subnational approaches. It's a fragmentation of power. Behind it is, of course, the big China-US equation, but underneath it is a much more complex picture of fragmentation of power towards growth markets, which are latecomers, which have not gone through the experience of World War II, and who feel their time to have the biggest piece of the cake is now, without necessarily understanding that world trade, investment, and finance needs a supportive infrastructure that enables a rule-based approach. So we're running a risk here of abandoning the rules of the game and not putting in place a new construct. It's a big risk because failure to address it can lead to protectionism, it can lead to inward orientation, it can lead to a race to the bottom and back of our neighbor concepts. That's what history is teaching us again and again, and it's now up to policymakers, and the G7 was very strong at that point too. Hopefully, this fragmentation at the horizontal level will not lead to an erosion of the framework that supports openness and non-discrimination. But fragmentation also happens within countries, as established institutions are losing trust, partly because of digital empowerment of people, but partly because of other reasons that have to do with interconnectedness increasingly moving ahead. People increasingly define themselves by smaller tribal affinities, and it's more and more difficult to sustain the voice of the region at the center. Fragmentation within countries can also lead to chaos. It can feed into hate, violence, and extremism, as we see in many parts of the world. In this world of fragmenting power, the role of business is increasingly called upon to be also a voice of reason. In this world of fragmenting power, we need business statesmanship. We need corporate leaders who understand that politics, power, social change, environmental trends, and governance issues are connected, that it needs caretaking. And I would even argue, after 30 years of bashing governance, it's time to step back and to ask, how can we support the voice of reason at the center to make governance work again? Because at the end of the day, we need effective governments that are capable of providing the basic services, education, health, and so on. If we fail on that front, markets will not grow, markets will fail. So the call is now on business leaders to change gear, and not just to lobby for narrow advantages beyond taxes, regulation, or other issues, but to also recognize that their long-term interest goes with the interest of the markets where they operate. Business statesmanship is now what would be needed most. So the future is up for grab. The future is in our hands. The future is what we make out of it. Corporate sustainability will become a transformative force if the world stays open and peaceful by and large. So finally, I want to share a few personal lessons. And I'm a bit reluctant to do so because knowledge and experience is by and large tacit. By and large. And it's very difficult to find the right words at the right moment. There's always a risk that you only share part of it. You would need to write a book, and even then, Sir Mark has written a book, Responsible Leadership. I highly, highly, highly recommend it. It says almost everything, and I'm not sure what I can add or what I can say. I decided to share 7 points, 7 lessons learned. The first one, I would call it, the enemy is us. Human suffering is man-made. 70 countries suffer from systemic corruption. Over 1 billion people live under fear because of failing government governance. It's all man-made. We have the capacity to change. We have all the solutions we need, be it on climate change and poverty, but we find it difficult to apply them. Why? Because we have our internal selfishness, which often hinders us from collaborating. It's because we are driven partly by fear, partly by the myths of the past, which make us unable to act in the voice of reason in its broadest sense. We have to overcome this at the personal level. We have to overcome this at the organizational level. It is a very, very personal call at the end of the day. I think corporate sustainability at the end is about knowing what is right and what is wrong, and understanding that individual people both have in them the capacity to do the worst things humanity can think of, but also to do the most beautiful thing humanity can do. And we need to renew this faith in doing the right thing almost on a daily basis. It is a very, very ethical call at the end of the day. The enemy is us. We are all capable of doing good things and the worst things. And that translates into organizational behavior, but it starts clearly at the very, very personal level. Secondly, and this may sound very trivial too, and it's all actually very simple, we cannot predict the future. Very, very important. In many parts of the world, Northeast Asia, Pakistan, India, parts of Africa, parts of Europe, many grievances of the past are a dark cloud for the future. If people, societies, do not come to grips with their own history and their past, they're blurred. Their vision is blurred for the future. It is very important to go through history and to work out the grievances of the past in order to have a clear horizon for the future. Commerce and trade plays an important role in this, because through the habit of interchanges, business can help to overcome grievances of the past. Through building practices of cooperation and repeating them, business can be ambassadors of peace. They can build understanding. They can be a bridge. Commerce and trade connect people and nations. They also can connect grievances indirectly and contribute to a culture of peace. Very important. And this is an important function in the statesmanship of the corporate in the 21st century in particular. Thirdly, I'm also convinced that what connects us is much, much stronger than what divides us. The forces that humanity are glued together are so strong because at the fundamental level, all people everywhere, irrespective of where they're born, have the very, very same aspirations, identical. Humanity, in that regard, has one narrative. There's clearly a universality of aspirations. And our interconnectedness is ever stronger due to technology and many other factors. Yes, our capacity to act together may not keep pace with the level of interdependence, but at the core, there are very, very strong affinities. And business has long understood that going global means being local everywhere, have long understood that indeed building a culture of inclusiveness, of non-discrimination, is the way forward. It makes sense to build on what connects us rather than amplify what divides us. Fourthly, homo ludens is alive and everywhere, entrepreneurship. And it's really encouraging because whether it's in Guayaquil or in Calcutta, everywhere in the world, people have a desire to experiment, to explore, to build. It's a wonderful, wonderful character of humanity. Entrepreneurship, the ability to take risks, to be driven by ideas, to create and to build. Celebrating and supporting responsible entrepreneurship, I think, is key for overcoming many of the problems we are facing, and there are many, many great projects and initiatives. But we should remind ourselves that entrepreneurship is genuinely part of the human character, very deep and very, very alive everywhere. And again, it's proof to the point that there's a universality of humanity because people everywhere like to play and to discover. and that is very encouraging, the notion of entrepreneurship. Then my fifth lesson would be, change from within is possible. Many people will argue, who work in big organizations or bureaucracies, that it's impossible to bring change upon. Not true. We have seen many corporate changes that happen because individuals within companies have taken on the course and have made that course so forceful that in the end, the CEO and the leadership fell in line with it. What does it take to bring about change from within? I think four ingredients. A good idea, dedication to make this idea work, winning over the leadership you need it at the end of the day, without it, it doesn't work. And then of course, you need to be able to execute flawlessly and to bring the proof that the idea actually delivers value. With this in mind, I think any idea can be built, any idea can be grown. And I must admit that part of my motivation working out of the United Nations, which is a big bureaucracy, has also been to bring the evidence that it is possible to renew the United Nations from within. To me, as somebody who firmly believes in the ideas of the UN, this has been an important motivation force from day one, just to bring the evidence that it is possible. Sixth, ethical leadership is in high demand. I think you would agree with me that in many places around the world, governance crisis has to do with leadership crisis, be it in the corporate world, and Michael mentioned some figures, or be it in the political world. We have become very obsessive with short-termism, and greed is widespread. We have to rediscover ethics and its meaning. And the premium for ethical leadership is ever getting higher. My personal advice to senior people always is, if you take on a leadership position, first make sure you kick your bad habits. Be aware of your bad habits and work on them. Try to get rid of them. Because if you keep your bad habits, you will most likely fall over them sooner or later. And I've seen many CEOs and many, many policy leaders fall over their own bad habits. And it starts at the very personal level. But the bigger call is indeed out there for ethical leadership, for long-term thinking, both in politics and in the private sector. My last point, and it may not surprise you, is idea power is the greatest power humanity has. Ideas can inspire, ideas can inflame hate, cause destruction. Ideas can contribute to peace and prosperity. The Global Compact is firmly embedded in the foundational spirit of the United Nations, in its foundational spirit, namely that interdependence, peace and prosperity can only be built on the pillars of openness and commerce. I believe in it very much, and I believe in a world that is increasingly open and interdependent. We have to renew our belief in this foundational spirit. And my advice and my recommendation and hope is that all of you will rediscover what the United Nations stands for and that you will continue to invest time in the Global Compact. I thank you very much.